Yes.
Keep me in the valley.
Hold it, hold it into your hands.
Hide me from the rain.
Yes. He's going to hide you from the rain.
Come on,
yes.
God is awesome.
Coming up live is our pastor, Pastor Randall Ferdinand. And the Helping Hands Ministry, we're going to go right into it.
Strength
in Jesus' name, it's already in progress. In Jesus' name, I have something to write with and something to write on. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come on,
thank you, Lord, for your gifts that free to manifest anytime they see fit. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, special faith, healing, miracles, discerning of spirit, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for all these things. Today, Lord, we're going to stand on your words because the entrance of your word gives us light. We're going to use that light as a guide to our path and alarm to our feet. If your church must grow, your people must know what thus said, Lord. Today, Lord, we ask for a receptive heart and listening ear. And we thank you, Lord, in advance for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Be seated. And turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 3. As we unfold, disclose, reveal, and proclaim what thus said the Lord. Today, I ask the speakers of the oracles of God. And as the psalmists have always said, let my tongue be as the pen of the ready writer. God will get all the praise and honor and glory that go unto his name. Now, we look at a study that we started some time ago, and sometime if we don't know what to do, well, then my favorite scripture is that my people, not people, but my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, because we don't know certain things, we are destroyed. And you make it available, God will be unjust to tell us we are destroyed for lack of knowledge and not make knowledge available to us. So it's available, but we have to search it out. It's the glory of God to conceal a thing, but we have to search it out. Amen. We're looking at this series that we title here, Enemies, are some of the greatest enemies to your faith. And some of the things that you see could affect your faith. Some of the things that you hear could affect your faith. Lack of knowledge, fear, and doubt, all these things are enemy to your faith. And if you don't know how to protect it, stay away from certain things. Be careful what you hear. I'll keep no evil thing before my eyes. Faith coming by hearing, and by hearing by the word of God, and certain things you have to do to grow your faith. Because when we are born again, everyone is given the measure of faith. Nobody's given more than anybody else. People in Asia, in Africa, in the Caribbean, doesn't get more than anybody else. Everybody's get the measure of faith. God used the same measure for white people, for black people, for male people, for female people, for young people, for old people. But then he said your faith could grow. You could add to your faith. You have to do something about your faith. Certain things you have to add to your faith. Add knowledge to your faith. Add temperance to your faith. Add virtue to your faith. Some things you have to add to your faith. When you get born again, you give you the measure of faith. Some things you have to add to it. So we can have a lot of things, but we're supposed to do something about some of the things that we have. If we don't do it, we're going to be at a disadvantage. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. So think about your faith. And if you don't have it, you're going to be in some trouble. Because when you're born again, you got the measure. Because we are saved by grace through faith. Now here, look at this story here in Matthew chapter 3, and let's pick it up at the 13th verse. Some of faith's greatest enemy. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan to be baptized by him. That is John the Baptist. John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee. Comest thou to me? Jesus answered and said, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh to fulfill all righteousness. Then suffer him. That word suffer means permit or allow. Verse 16. Jesus, when he was baptized, went straightway out of the water, and lo, heaven opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Now, John the Baptist baptized our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus say, but John is saying, you come for me to baptize you, I have need to be baptized of you. And then a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, hear him. So John heard that. He's the one that shows. He said, I must decrease, and he have to increase, and so on. So John knows something about our Lord and Savior. Is that true? He's the one pointers to John, our Lord and Savior. We want to read those verses again. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan, unto John to be baptized of him. John forbid him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee. Comest thou to me? Jesus answered and said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh to follow all righteousness. Then he suffered, that will suffer mean permit or allow. Jesus, when he was baptized, went straightway out of the water, and lo, heaven opened upon him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So John was a witness to all these things that you have seen. Now look at something in Big John chapter 1. Look at Big John chapter 1 and see what Jesus is saying to us through the Apostle John. Big John chapter 1. Now, John the Baptist baptized our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and he knew him because he said, "You come to me to be baptized, I need to come to you." And he heard a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son." He also saw the Spirit like a dove, lightning, and staying on top John the Baptist. So he knew that's the man. Like on the day of Pentecost, when it was in the upper room, they said there was tongues of fire upon everybody. I used to tell him, well, that's the real thing there. That's the Holy Ghost baptism, the Holy Ghost and fire. So here, Big John chapter 1, and look at verse 32. John bear record saying, "I saw Spirit descending from heaven like a dove and abiding upon him." So John saw that. Verse 33. "I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he that baptized with the Holy Ghost and with fire." Look at verse 34. Put your finger in verse 34. Look at the 34th verse. "And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God." So John the Baptist said, that's the Son of God. Is that true? We're looking at some of the greatest enemies to your faith. We look at ignorance is one of them. Fear is one of them. Doubt is one of them. Some of the things that you see, "I'll keep no evil thing before my eye," that will affect your faith. What you hear will affect your faith. Well, your environment will also affect your faith. Your environment depends where you are. Now look at this. Listen to this. John baptized our Lord and Savior. John, he said, "There is no prophet like John. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffer violent, and the violent take it by force." He said, "Among men that is born of women, there is not a greater than John the Baptist." Jesus said about John the Baptist. Now, Jesus was baptized by John. John saw the Spirit coming upon Jesus. The Spirit of God said, that's him who he baptized. Look at this. Your environment could affect your faith. Look at this. Look at Matthew chapter 11. Look at Matthew chapter 11. You see, you have to be careful where you go, what you're seeing, what you're hearing is going to affect your faith, because without faith, it's impossible to please God. In other words, faith is what you need in the realm of the Spirit to buy what you want. Faith is spiritual money. If you don't have no faith, you can't buy anything in the realm of the Spirit. In that kingdom, you need faith. And you have to be careful that you let nobody get in the way and withdraw money from your spiritual bank account, because you can go to make a withdrawal and you can find that there's no funds in the account. And you could write a check and it could return to you insufficient funds or no funds at all. Amen. Look at this, Matthew chapter 11. Pick it up at verse 1. Matthew chapter 11 on verse 1. "And it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. Now when John had heard it in prison, the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples, said unto them, Are thou he that should come after, or should we look for another?" Now he's in prison now. He's doubting whether this is the Christ. You remember, he baptized Jesus Christ. He saw the Spirit of God coming upon him. He heard a voice come from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son." Now he's in, look at that environment he's in. He's questioning now, is this the Christ, or should we look for another? Could you imagine that, deacon? He baptized him, he saw him, and now he's questioning whether this is the Christ. You see, you can get so tired in that world out there, after a while you start questioning whether I'm saved.
Amen.
And you start wondering, when I die, you try to think about it. Am I going to heaven when I die? Am I doing everything right? No, he baptized our Lord and Savior. He heard the voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son." He saw the Spirit alight upon him. Look at what he asked. Look at it. Look at verse 3. Said unto him, look at verse 2. "Now John heard that in prison." You see, that prison environment could take a toll on you. Yes. What kind of environment is prison environment? Do you think they have in church service there and saying, "Glory, glory, glory, hallelujah"? John is put in prison there. He's questioning whether this is the Lord. Look at it. "Now when John heard in prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples saying, Are thou he that, or should we look for another?" Jesus answered and said to them, go and show John those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Blessed is he who is not offended me. And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitude concerning John, what went you out for to see in the wilderness? A reed shaken in the wind? But what went you out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, he that wears soft raiment are in the king's houses. But what went you out for to see? A prophet? I say unto you, more than a prophet. For this is he that is whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before my face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that is born of women, there is not risen a greater than John the Baptist, notwithstanding that he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffer violent, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesy until John. And if you will receive it, this is Elias, which is for to come. He that have to hear, let him hear. But here John, in prison now, questioning whether this is the Lord. You see, your environment could take its toll, and you mess with the wrong part of people long enough, you hear a lot of foolishness from that world out there, and you stay in their company, that could affect your faith. John the Baptist, who baptized our Lord and Savior, who heard the voice from excellent glory, who saw the Spirit come upon him, he's questioned, is that him? Well, if that could happen to John, it could happen to you. Your environment could affect your faith. Your environment could affect you. You can get with the wrong people, and you could hear them talk a lot of foolishness all day long. And in that environment, these people are not saved, but it's contaminated with a lot of evil spirit. They could affect your faith. Can you see that? Amen, amen, amen and amen. Look at Job. Look at Job. Is Job in the Bible? Yes. Just want to make sure we're in the B-I-B. Job chapter 1. John the Baptist is questioning whether this is the Lord. He baptized him. He saw the Spirit upon him. He heard the voice of him, but he's questioning. Is this he, or should we look for another? He said, go show John what you see. The blind receive their sight, the deaf hear, the lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised, devils are cast out, the poor have the gospel preached to them. Go and tell him. Because you could get yourself in some areas and you start questioning your salvation. You're in the wrong surrounding, your environment, your surroundings, the condition or the circumstances or the influences around you, your environment. Job chapter 1, look at this man. Verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. The man was perfect and upright, one that feared God and eschew evil. There was born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance was also 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camel, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 she-asses, and a very great household of servants, a great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men in these. Now this seemed to be a perfect man. I mean, he has everything. He loved the Lord, hated evil. He have all this. A lot of people work for him. And he loved the Lord and hated evil. Greatest man in these. Watch this. Look how your environment could affect you. Look how your environment could affect you. Look at verse 2. Chapter 2. Satan, God gives Satan permission. You notice something else. There's a little facet of revelation here, that the devil had to go to God to get permission to do anything to you. You see, his crowd, he could do what he could well please. Because they said, the devil go before the throne, and he's the accuser of our brethren. Not the brethren, our brethren. You see, those folks who work in family, don't complain about them. Complain about you. Night and day he go before them. So the day when the sons of God came to present, they said, for the Lord, Satan came also. God said, from whence comest thou? From going to and fro in the earth and walking up and down in it. And he said, my servant Job, and he have to give permission. He said, you couldn't go because you can get yourself in so much mess. And Jesus is your defense attorney. And he keep putting off the case all the time. And this Satan keep coming back with that case. Satan is the prosecuting attorney. And Jesus is the defense attorney. You see, they could bring up this case. They see you living this ungodly life from January to December, year in, year out. Because, you see, you have to get Bible things and put it together. He said, 3 years now I come looking for fruits. Where's the fruits? They said, well, cut it down. In other words, let Satan have his way, kill him. But he said, all right, God, we're going to give me another year to dig it and dung it. If it bear fruits, well, if not, you're going to cut it down. See, he's coming back. The accuser of our brethren day and night before the throne. So you live in that ungodly life and ungodly life and ungodly life. So, but permission have to be granted. before you can interfere with you. The case have to say, put up his hand and say, no, the young man who was having an affair with his father's wife. You see, he said, such a one should be put to death. But he said, all right, we're going to plea bargain this case. So what they do, they kill the young man and they take the spirit. So Satan take the body and we take the spirit. So see, every time they come, he say, any branch in me that is not bearing fruits, I cut it down. Any branch in me that is bearing fruits, I purge it that they bring forth much fruit. You don't just want fruits, you want much fruit. God expects you to grow. You see, every time he comes looking for fruits and there's no fruit, you're not growing in the things of God. You're not getting better. You're not paying your tithes. You're not coming to church. You're not reading your Bible. You're not living a good life. You're living how somebody you're not married to, and on and on and on. You see, the accuser, the brethren, he go and he accuse. And they put off the case and he accuse. And they put off the case and they accuse. But how much time are you going to put off this case? He said, 3 years now I come looking for fruits. No fruit. Cut it down. You see, after a while you're going to live. So they went to God and God gave them permission to do what they want to Job. Tell him, take all his stuff. And they take all his stuff. Now he said, put the other sick, but don't take his life. Can't take his life. Had to get permission. You see, you have to go to God and show God why I want to kill him. Why I want to take away his health. Why? You're doing something. And sometimes we don't know what it is because my people are destroyed for lack of. All right. Job, we saw that he's a very wealthy man. Job chapter 2, look at verse 7. So went Satan from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sores and boils from the sole of his foot unto the crown. And he looked with potsherd and scraped himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. Then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. You see, you could get yourself in that situation because one man, you see, he's the richest man of these, have everything going for him, have it made in the shade, so to speak. Is that true? Now bad times come, wife say, curse God and die. Verse 10, he said unto her, dost thou speak as one of the foolish women speaketh? What? Shall we receive good of the hands of God, and shall we not receive evil? In all this did Job sin not. Now Job had three friends. Look at this. Job had three friends who heard of all the evil that was come upon him, and they came, every one of his friends, Eliphaz, the Temites, and Bildad, the Shuhite, and Zophar, the Naamite, for they had made an appointment together to come to mourn with him and to comfort him. And when they lift up their eyes afar off, and they knew him not, and they lift up their voices and wept, and rent every one his mantle, and sprinkled dust upon their heads and towards the heaven. So they sat down with him upon the ground 7 days and 7 nights, none speak a word unto him, for they saw the grief was very great. So from that very exalted position, no bad times come. That will affect your faith. That will affect your faith. You see, now all your friends come and they accuse him. They figure that he did something bad, but we'll get to that in a little while. So from that point, you see, your environment, now you come in that hospital environment, in that sick environment, because remember, all his money gone, all his kids gone, all his wealth, everything gone. He's flat broke now. He ain't got nothing. What would be your behavior? God going to bring this up before some of you Christians. You know what he's going to say? Job wasn't saved. With all this, he didn't curse God. He maintained his integrity. He's not saved. God going to bring up Joseph before you. You say Joseph was a young man, not saved, 17 years old, 18 years old in Potiphar's house. Every time Mrs. Potiphar come, he resisted. I'm going to bring that up before you Christian. He has servants, you a son. He going to bring up Jacob before you. He waited 7 years for his wife. What problem, Christian? Why couldn't you wait? You say he wasn't saved. Well, what? He wasn't saved. He waited 7 years. And to give him Leah, he had to wait the next 7 years to get Rachel. But he keep his mind fixed on the woman that he loved. So he going to bring up all this before you. With all that Job went through, what will you be like if all your wealth and your health and your family gone? And we read it in the last chapter. They come and they say they take away his children, they take away his wealth, they take away his house, they take away his, no, they take away his health. What would be your reaction? Your environment could affect your faith. Watch this. Job chapter 4. Job chapter 4. Watch this. Pick it up at the third verse. You see, when he was in exalted position, but how would you behave? Is it about your money? Is it about your education? Or is it about God? Look at this. Job chapter 4, look at verse 3. Behold, thou hast instructed many, and thou hast strengthened the weak hands. He had a lot of money. He called his shot. A lot of people worked for Job. He was the man. Verse 4. Thy words have upholden him that was fallen, and thou hast strengthened the feeble knees. But now, your environment will affect your faith. Your environment will affect your faith. You get between a rock and a hard place, you start questioning. Look at it. But now it's come upon thee, and thou faintest. Thou touchest thee. If thou touchest thee, thou art troubled. Is not the fear of thy confidence and thy hope and thy uprightness thy way? Remember, I pray thee, who perish, being innocent, or where is the righteous cut off? Even as I have seen, they that plow iniquity and sow wickedness shall reap the same. So the accuser go up thinking that he did something bad. Well, he did something. He did something. God is not an unjust God. People say God was testing Job. That's a lot of foolishness. I have a lot of children that did everybody. Don't go mess with them. Here is a man who perfect, love God and hate evil, but God going to kill all his children, take all his wealth, take health and go test him. No, Job did something to bring that upon. Satan have to have a reason to come before Job, to accuse Job. You have to have a reason. But you see, now you were strong, now you're weak. How are you behaving now that you're weak? Now we're taking from that position. Are you the same person? Your environment will affect you. Here's John in prison, incarcerated. He questioned, is that the Christ? Or should we look for another? Yeah, your environment will affect you. You can get yourself between a rock and a hard place. Things could get out of control in your life, and you could start questioning your salvation. You could start questioning people around you. Because question learning, are your mind fixed on God? Because if you're not, from some years ago, this well-known evangelist fell from grace. We don't want to call anybody name. And I was part of a church. He was part of that same fellowship. And many pastors handing their credentials because he fell. Well, that's crazy. God gives some apostles, some prophet, some evangelists, some pastor, some teacher. If he fell, what would that have to do with you? Amen. You don't want to fail. So who your calling is with him or with God? Amen. And because of that, many of them handed a credential. They don't want to be a part because he fell. But he's not God. Amen. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. I will say, follow Christ as I follow Christ. If I fall, you have to fall for that. That's stupid. Now your faith should be, see again, your environment could affect your faith. Because when things are going good, fine. But we talk about a set of tapes you haven't filed. Unfaithful time in the time of trouble, a faithful friend in the time of trouble. You see, when everything is good, everybody's praise God, hallelujah. Wait until things get bad. You want to find out who's who? Wait until things get bad. Everybody getting paid, everybody, hallelujah. Glory to God. Yeah, take away your wealth. Take away your family, unless you behave. Your environment could affect you. Because how was it built? If God didn't build the house, the workman worked but in vain. If he doesn't watch the city, he worked but in vain. You see that? Now everything that he had, now look at it. Now there was a time he upholding, he had money, he could call the shot. Thousands of people worked for Job. Now we don't have it anymore. Now he need help, because all his wealth gone, all his family gone, everything gone from him. So he's down there. How would you behave? They say with all that he maintained his integrity, he never changed. How would you change? God going to bring this up before some of you go say, Job wasn't saved. All that money, you see sometimes, you see the rich young ruler, he didn't have the money had him. What must I do to have eternal life? Well, he say, do the commandment. Love the neighbor as yourself, honor them, pay your tithes, and do all these things. Fine. He said, all that I observed from my youth. He said, one thing lack is God. Sell what you have, give it to the poor. You see, the money hold on to him. You see, Job had money. The money didn't have Job. You see, when the money gone, he's still Job. You see, Abraham had the money didn't have him. When he reached the end of his life, he handed over all the money to Isaac, his son. You see, he had the money. You see, Solomon had the money. The rich young ruler, the money had him. You see, and God looking at that, in your environment, how would you behave? I told the story here. I used to work with a company out in Queens, and we make these equipment. Most of them was for military equipment to use in the military, in the Navy and Air Force and so on. And these equipment have to go through what is called the environmental tests. You see, they put the equipment into a very cold temperature, 20, 30, 50 degrees minus. And it stayed there overnight for 24 hours working. It'd come back into a normal temperature, 70, 80 degrees Fahrenheit. It would go up to like 200 degrees Fahrenheit. and stayed there for 24 hours. Many of the equipment didn't make it. And they pulled them out of the chamber and put new equipment there to pass the test. And if it passed the test, then they sign off on those equipment and say they passed the environmental test. Well, you see, God is looking at that with you. How would you behave when you're rich and when you're poor? Paul said, I know how to abound and how to abase. I know how to behave when I'm poor and how to behave when I'm rich. You see, it doesn't affect me because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. Look at Jonah. Is Jonah in the Bible?
Yes.
All right, God called him to go to Nineveh. He don't want to go to Nineveh. He want to go to Tarsus. Well, you don't tell God, God tell you. Well, he had quite a strange environment to live in to get his act together. Sometimes the environment will change you. Sometimes you can change the environment. You see, God called you to do certain things. The gifts and calling of God is without repentance. God called you to do something. Some people think they could treat God like their parents. When God told them to fall on the ground, squeal and roll around, God will say, all right. If you don't want to do it, then do something else. God doesn't work like that.
Amen.
The gifts and calling of God is without repentance. Whatever he called you to do, you, that's it. He tell Paul, you go into the Gentiles. He tell Peter, you go into the Jews. He said, Peter, tell Jonah, you go into Nineveh. He want to go to Tarsus. And you could want to go where you want to. You go into Nineveh. And go the hard way to find his way to Nineveh. And because he was disobedient, look at Jonah chapter 1. Some of you still turn in, haven't been there for a while. I can see that. Well, you have 66 books of the Bible. You need to get that. In Jonah, he's our salvation. Hallelujah. They're still turning. They're still going. Wait for them. You on television, wait for them. On radio, wait for them. They're still turning. Amen. Your environment, all right. Hallelujah. You can get yourself like John the Baptist and you can start questioning. Your environment will take its effect on you. Your environment will take effect on you. Yeah, Job, I mean, you get there from, you know what it is to have all these mansions and all these people working for you. And we look at it just now, everything, while he yet speaking, the next one come. While he yet speaking, the next one come. While he yet speaking, and one behind the other. That's a precipitous fall. Is that true? That's a precipitous fall from one day. We have to read that. Let's turn to that. We're going to read that another bit. We had to read that again. That's a precipitous fall, Deacon. One day, I mean, you'll call the bank and you have $100 billion in the bank in the morning. And afternoon, you'll have a yellow penny. Or what color is the penny? Yeah, what color is the copper? All right. Look at Jonah. Jonah chapter 1. Look at the 17th verse. Your environment. Could affect your faith.
17?
Yeah, 17. Look at verse 17. Now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now how many know Jonah is in heaven today? Is Jonah in heaven?
Amen.
Jonah is in heaven today. What would you ask Jonah when you see him in heaven? How was the accommodation there? Well, you know, the bathroom a little tight, you know. What did you eat there, Jonah, for 3 days and three nights? A little tight, you know, tight accommodation. But your environment, you see, when you get yourself in that, and now he's calling out to God. God tell him to do something, you run somewhere else. Now you get in that strange environment. Isn't that something? Look at it. Now the Lord had prepared great fish to swallow Jonah 3 days, three nights, and fish belly, and so on. When you go down to second chapter right over, and look at Jonah. Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish belly. Now, you know, Hezekiah, sick unto death, he turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord and said, God, remember me. I wonder if he was doing that all the time, if he will have to do it. No, now he get into trouble. Now he prayed to the Lord. Now God say, get your house in order, you're going to die. Oh, now he praying. You see, now he's in the fish belly. Now he prayed to God. Look at it. And Jonah prayed unto the Lord, his God, out of the fish belly and said, I cry by reason of my affliction. My affliction unto the Lord, and he heard me out of the belly of the fish, and I cry, and he heard my voice. Now, isn't that something? Isn't that something? God hear Jonah in the fish's belly under the water. So, if God could hear, you see, facet of revelation there, if he could hear Jonah under the water, don't you think he could hear you? And Jonah wasn't saved. And he cried to the Lord, and God heard him. God maybe have some kind of ears. You see, we miss sometimes. We cry out to God and think that, you see, anything we ask according to His will, He hears us. You see, because God is omnipresent and God is omniscient and God is omnipotent. And sometimes we limit God. The 78th Psalm and the 41st verse say, we limit the Holy One of God because we think God is like man. That we have to squeal to God for Him to hear. That we have to keep crying out to Him all the time for Him to hear. He cried out to the God and God heard Him. Look at this. And God heard His voice. Verse 3. For thou hast cast me into the deep, into the midst of the seas, and the flood come past me about, all the billows and the wave pass over me. Then I said, I am cast out of sight, yet I would look on to the holy temple. I wonder how we know what should look with the temple in the fish belly. How we know which way is east, west, north, and south. I lift up my head, my eyes to the hill from whence cometh thy help. I wonder if you know where the hill was. And the water come past me about, even the souls, the depth closed around about me, and the weed and wrapped round about my head. I went down to the bottom of the mountain, the bottom of the mountain, and the earth and the bars were about me forever. Thou hast brought me up my life from corruption, O my God. And when my soul fainted within me, I remember the Lord. I remember the Lord. One of the things that when, you see, again, when he in the fish, notice his memory went with him. You notice the rich man and Lazarus, his memory went with him. Remember in thy lifetime, thou received a good thing and Lazarus evil thing. Remember your memory. Now remember God. But you notice, deacon, you notice he know who to call on? Why didn't he call on the bishop? Why didn't he call the Pharisee or the Sadducee? You notice he know who to call on? Look at it. When my soul fainted, verse 7 within me, I remember the Lord. My prayers came unto thee in the holy temple. In the holy temple. In the holy temple. Your environment. In the holy temple. In the holy temple. In the holy temple. They that observe lying vanities forsake their own mercies. But I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. In the belly of the whale, thanksgiving. I will pray that I may have vow, salvation is the Lord. And the Lord speak unto the fish. All these are facets of revelation. Here is God speaking to a fish. Fish have soul and body. Humans have spirit, soul and body. And God been speaking to some of you for years and you wouldn't listen. When some of you go before God, he's going to bring all this, he's going to bring up to you. Here he commanded the ravens to feed Elisha bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening. And the ravens was faithful to bring Elisha food every single day. Here is God speak to the fish and tell him where to carry because he's out in the ocean. If the fish is that big, it have to be a very huge fish. And big, large fish have to be in deep waters. And he speak to the fish there, and the fish have to find land and go on the land. And if we could sort of magnify God and know how big God is, and look at the environment that he, you see, his faith was put through the test. But notice sometimes some people, when they get it back against the wall, then they remember God. Amen. They remember to come to church, remember to pay the tithes, but remember God when they're in trouble. Now he's going to get your house in order, going to die. Now you're going to pray to the Lord. Now he's in the belly of the whale. Look at these verses. Look at verse 9. I will sacrifice unto thee with a voice of thanksgiving. Yeah, you know to give thanks now. Why didn't he do it before? When God sent him, why didn't he do it before? You see, your environment will affect your faith. No? I will sacrifice unto thee with voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that which I vowed. If a man vow a vow, no, keep it. He said, you could be in serious trouble. Now, I make a vow. He's making a vow. You notice where he's making a vow? In the belly of the whale. Salvations of the Lord. The Lord speak unto the fish, and the fish vomit up Jonah on dry land. How do you like that? Your environment would affect you. Matthew chapter 13. Your environment, your surroundings, the conditions, the circumstances, the influences, your environment. Matthew chapter 13. Faith's greatest enemies. You can get yourself like John the Baptist. You can start questioning whether you're saved or not, whether Jesus is Lord. You can be there. You get too far away from the things of God and you stop putting money in your spiritual bank account and you want to go and write a check to what you have and you realize that you don't have enough money because you're not making spiritual deposits. Stop coming to church, stop paying your tithes, stop being what you used to be, and you're flying high with things of God. Job one is a precipitous. We're going to go back to Job in a little while and see from 1 minute you're way up there to right down. But with all that, he maintained his integrity. God going to bring all that before some of y'all. Once you don't get your way, you fall apart like on a 99 cents watch. Fold up like a cheap table and put in a corner. You know, you get your way. People are saying, yes. Hallelujah. He taken here about the man, the sword that went forth to sow. And some fell by the wayside and so on. Look at this. Hallelujah. The environment. Matthew chapter 13, picking up at verse 1. The same day Jesus went out of the house and sat by the seaside. And great multitudes were gathered together, insomuch that they went into a ship and he sat down and the multitude stood on the shore. And he speak many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured. Some fell on stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith it sprang up because it had not much depth of earth. When the sun was risen up, it scorched it, and because it had not much root, it withered away. Some fell among thorns, and it sprang up and choked it. Some fell on good ground, bring back 130, and so on. But you notice each of these had their own environment. You notice that each of them, some fell on waysides, stony ground, and thorns. Each of them have to function in their environment. And depends on the, look at this. Now he's going to tell us a little more about what it means. Go on to verse 18. Look at verse 18. Hear therefore the parables of the sower. When any man hear these words of the kingdom and understand them not, here cometh the wicked one and catch away that which was sown in his heart, and that which he had received by the razor. And this is which what you reached by the seaside. Now look at those two verses again. Look at verse 18 again. Hear therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catch away that which was sown in his heart. This is which was received by the wayside. But he that received the seed on stony places, the same as he that heard the word of God, and anon or immediately with joy receive it. Yet he had not much root in himself, and drew it for a while, and when tribulation and persecution arise because of the word, by and by he is offended. He also that received the seed among thorns is he that heard the word, and cares, heard the word, and the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, choke the word and become it unfruitful. And he that received the seed in good ground is he that earned. But notice four different set of seeds. One seed, same sower, different soil. You notice that? Same seed, because the sower have good seeds for all of them, but some fell on wayside, some fell on stony ground, some fell on thorn. And how they're going to function there, it depends on not the sower or the seed, is the environment. Well, you see, some of you were sown in stony places. Some of you were sown among thorns. Look at it again. He that heard the word of God and understood it not. You understand it not. Well, whose job it is to understand it? Is God or yours? That's yours. So you could receive the word, understand it not. Well, God give you understanding. He put a handle to the word. We look at the interpreter. What does the interpreter do? That he put there, God gives some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors. What for? For the perfecting of the saints, for the word. Because God will be on just God to give you something that you can't do, and he'll give you a check that you couldn't cash. You see? Because all of us are going to be in different environments. As you travel, some of you have the ability to travel. You go down to Haiti, and you go to Trinidad, you go to Africa. All these are different environments. And you would have to learn to function in those environments. How are you going to function? Are you going to change because of the environment? You're the same all the time. The seed is the same all the time. The soil is the same all the time. It's about the soil. So you're going to have to learn to function in all these soils. And some have fallen good ground, some bring forth 30 and so on. But look at 22. He that received the seed among thorns is he that hearing the word of God, and because of the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches, choked the word, didn't bring forth anything. Now, is not God get you busy in money and all these things, it's you. Get yourself in that. There that fell among the wayside, that's you. You do something about it because you don't come to church much, you didn't water the seed, and when the sun rose up, or when You'll be offended because people criticize you and call you a Christian, call you Bible toter, and speak in tongues and call you a fool and you take any money and go to church like that. You become offended. If you're not giving it with a willing heart, if you're not giving it cheerfully, it's not going to work. Mm-hmm. You see, it's up to you. I've been in places where people, I mean, you as a Christian, you don't feel welcome. And they don't like you there. You know it. I know it. God knows it, the devil knows. But you still have to function there because he put you there as a light in a dark place. He put it there as salt to prevent decay. So you're going to have all these different environments, but how are you going to function? Job was at one time way up there, precipitously fall right down. How did he be? All that, they say he cursed not, or he was offended. His wife said, curse God and die. Yeah, but how would you behave in a stony environment if you fall by the wayside, if you fell among thorn, how would you behave? The soil is the same, the seed is the same, but you have different environment. Your environment could affect you. Because if you come to church, some people come to church, they have no Bible, they're sitting there all the time. Well, you'll never get any understanding of the word. So the Satan will take up whatever you learned here today and say, what did he say about stony places? He take it away from your heart. Then they that fell among stony ground is what? They hear the word of God. Everybody hear the word of God. What do you do with it? You never come back to Bible study. You never go home and go over the scripture and read again. So you didn't water the seed. So when the sun come up, when the affairs of life come up, you have no fruits. Then those fall among thorns. You leave here today, now you're busy with real estate and this and stocks and bonds and making money, everything. You didn't do anything with it. Everybody get the same word. But what you do with your word? You see, environment can affect it. Because you're going out to work tomorrow. When you get to work tomorrow, all you're talking about is money and real estate and this and talking about, never talk about the word of God. Well, if you talk more about the things of the world, you'll have more of the things of the world because you're tapping into a spiritual law. You'll get whatever you say. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast in the sea, and not doubt in his heart, but believe the thing which he say, shall come, you shall have whatsoever he say. So all you're talking about is things that, and never talk about things of God. You see, your environment could affect your faith. Can you see that? Amen. Look at this here, Luke chapter 15. Look at the prodigal son. I'll be very careful. Some places I'm not going there because I don't want to be in that area to affect my faith. Because my faith makes things work. Amen. Hallelujah. Faith is spiritual money. Hallelujah. Some of faith's greatest enemy is your environment. Where you been? Where you sowing that seed? Do we have enough water to bring a crop? Do we have enough going there to get it? Luke chapter 15. And look at the prodigal son. Pick it up at verse 11. Your environment. Hallelujah. Have you ever been, you've been there, well, all of us been there, been to some places called church, but there's nothing there. You don't have the seed, you don't have the soil. You can have the best seed and the best soil. If you don't have any water, Paul planted, Apollo watered it, God gave it the increase. If there's no water, you could have the best seed and the best soil, no water. You see, the teacher is the waterer. Amen. The teacher is the waterer. You see, we talk about the environment. You could have the best, but you have no water in that environment, you're not going anywhere. Most of the world is in famine because of no water. Is that true? No water. You need water. Luke 15, pick it up at verse 11. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that fall to me, and divide them unto his living. And not after many days, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country and wasted his substance with righteous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land and began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to the citizens of that country, and they sent him into the fields to feed swine. See the environment? Watch this. Look at verse 16. And would fill his belly with a husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. How many have been there? Once the money finished, everybody's gone. Verse 17. And when he came to himself, notice he's in a strange environment. He's a different environment, but you have to change that environment. When he come to himself. That's what happened to everyone. You, when you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, you have to do something about it. You have to do something about it. You're the one who have to do something about it. You are the custodian of that body. You see, God couldn't come in there. He said, I stand at the door knocking. If any man will hear and open, I'll come in. If you don't open, he can't come in. He don't live there. You the boss there. Look at this. Look at verse 17. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servant of my father have enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? You notice, he noticed that environment where he come from is good. This one is a bad environment in. And he changed him because he come from, look at this. I will arise and go to my father, and I say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I am no more worthy to be called thy son, but make me a hired servant. From a son to a servant. You see that? Now, is the environment that he get in turn him from wanting to be a son to a servant? How many of you had it good working the things of God and was God's son? And you went back out. The Bible says, in the last days, many shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devil. So once being a son, going back out to be a servant. You see that? Leave your environment. Leave his father's house. But he remember. That memory is something else. I remember my father's house, there's many. And I could just be a hired servant to my father. But the father love doesn't change. Look at verse 19. I no more wanted to be called thy son, but make me what I have a servant. And he arose and came to his father's. And when he was yet a great way off, the father saw him and had compassion on him, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto his father, I have sinned against heaven. But notice something else in Revelation there. Notice the father saw him a good way off. Notice the father was always looking for him. You notice the father loved him, hasn't changed. Notice the father is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Yeah. He might have changed, he changed his environment, but the father love for him never changed. Father said the same all the time. Notice that? And when he was a great way off, so I mean the father was always looking for his son. Always looking for his son. You see that? And now he don't want to be a son, now he want to be a servant. See, environment could be something else. What could get in, you come from a very wealthy home, what could get into you that you could come to your father and say, don't make me a son anymore, just make me a hired servant. You see the environment affecting. He doesn't see the father anymore as daddy. Now we see him as his boss. Now we see him as an employer. Don't see him as daddy anymore. See, and so what your environment could do, you could get out there and riotous living with prostitute and drug using, all that, and everything that you have had in the father's house. Now you want to just, I'm not worthy to be called a son anymore. Make me a servant. You see, environment could do things like that. People go out there and they mess up and they come back home to their wives, come back home to their family, and they just feel they're not worthy anymore because the things they do, they embarrass the family with drugs and sex and all the mess, prison and all this kind of mess. And they feel they're not worthy. People leave here, this fellowship here, and they've gone out, and you see, but this father here is always looking for you. And my love for you is always the same, never change. You see, I have to act like God. I have to, you see, Jesus said to me one time, in, you know, the spirit ministered to me one time, said, be me for me. Be me for me. He said, if I was here, this is what I would do. So if you dare, do this for me. You see, they come back, I leave. I never tell them to leave. I never tell them anything. But you see, he gone now and he feels so unworthy because they did a lot of bad stuff and they say a lot of bad stuff. But you see, that doesn't affect me. You see, God make me like this, that things like that doesn't affect me. Other people, they know the thin skin, anything you say about them, they. But he come back, but the revelation, the father is looking for him all the time. And he come back into the father's house. Make me a hired servant. Or what could get into you from that exalted position, being the son of God, to be a servant of the devil? Can you see that? And he arose and came, verse 22, and when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. How many would like to have that kind of treatment? His environment. Can you see that? Acts, Paul on his way to Rome. Your environment could affect your faith. Your environment could affect your faith. Hallelujah. Some fell by the wayside. Some fell on stony ground. Some fell among thorns. Those environment. What are you doing here? Hallelujah. But notice what he saw doesn't change. The seed doesn't change. You notice that? The soil is the same. The seed and the soil is the same. Look at this. Paul on his way to Rome. Look at this. Mighty Paul, who wrote most of the New Covenant, chief of his apostle, operating in three ministries as a teacher, as an evangelist, as an apostle. Look at the Apostle Paul. The environment could affect you. You get in the wrong place, you could be affected. I don't care who you are. Even Jesus. Look at this. Listen to this. Even Jesus. When Jesus got on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? In the Garden of Gethsemane, he said, "Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me." My father said, "No." He went back and prayed a second, "Let this cup pass from me." I say, "Not my will, but thy will." Now he get on the cross from midday to 3 in the afternoon. And you could get that person. Now you notice he didn't call him Father. My God. You see, to the world, he's God, but to us, he's Father and God. Now he on the cross, because there's a scripture in him. Listen to this. Your environment is something else. You on the cross, hanging there, after kick and spit, and you're hanging there from 12 to 3 in the afternoon. Your environment could affect you. Now Jesus in the cross, there's a scripture in John 10 and verse 30 says, "The Father and I are one." Is that true? 1 John 5 and verse 7, "The Father, the Word, and the Spirit, one." But Jesus got on the cross and he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" As the darkest hour, brother. He's not daddy. God. You see, he became sin for you and I. And the world, because after his death, burial, and resurrection, then we had a new birth, we could call him daddy. The only person who could call him daddy is Jesus. So that on there, when he went up there on Calvary, after he spent the 3 hours there, and he became sin, separated from God. God is not his Father now, he's God. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Those are dark hours. He had never known separation in all eternity from his Father. But his environment delivered into ungodly men, spit and kick on him, beat him and put him on the cross, leave him there. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? First time in all eternity, separated from his Father, his environment. Could happen to you too. You could stay away from the church long enough, stop reading your scripture, stop coming for Bible study, stop having hands laid on you, and you all can, and you just keep piling up your own, you have a spiritual debt to pay. And you're moving further and further away from the things of God. And in the midnight hour now, you're sick, and you're trying to pray, you don't know what to say. You have no more spiritual energy. People leave this ministry here, and everything working fine for them. A year, 2 years. After a while, they realize that they have no more spiritual gasoline. And whatever they're doing is not working anymore. They run out of spiritual gasoline. And they're trying to go to other places to get it. But what they get in there is synthetic. It's not authentic. They have to come back here for me to lay hands on them for the authentic person. Because I have the DNA. The folks over there don't got it. I got it. You see, that's not your parents. You were born here. I have the information. I have the DNA information. They don't have it. They have some synthetic something over there. But that's not it. Look at this, Paul on his way to Rome. And look at this, your environment. Affect everybody, including our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Paul on his way to Rome, look at this, verse 20. Acts chapter 27, verse 20. Acts chapter 27, verse 20. Your environment, we just about all the time, you have a few minutes to go, let's use it wisely. Look at verse 20. "When neither sun nor stars in many days appear, no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we," underline "we," "should be saved was taken away." Look at it. We, all of us, look at it. "When neither stars, when only sun nor stars appear, no small tempest lay on us," underline "us," "and all hope that we," Paul included, "should be taken away was taken away. But after a long absence, Paul stood forth in the midst of them and said, 'Sirs, you should have hooked on to me and should have not loosed from Crete to have gained this harm and this loss. But now I exhort you, be of good cheer. There's no loss shall be of any man life among you but the ship." The ship going to be destroyed. Verse 23. "There stood by me this night an angel of God whose I am and whom I serve, saying, 'Fear not, Paul, for thou must be brought before Caesar, and God hath given me all them that with them sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheers. I believe God and shall be as he has told me.'" 3 days and three nights, everything that could go wrong, go wrong. Paul scared just like everybody else. We. Yeah, mighty purpose, but we. I know. You could get in an environment out there, all hope that we should be saved was gone. All. Look at verse 20. "And when neither sun nor stars appear in many days, no small tempest lay on us. All hope that we is taken away. You could get yourself there. I've been there. and you start questioning whether you had made the right decision, whether God is hearing you, whether God is here, you can get yourself to mind. You think God is a zillion miles away. You've been there. Yes. I've been there. Going to God, is God hearing me? Well, you could get there and you start questioning your faith, whether you was ever saved, whether your prayer was ever answered. You could get there. All hope that we should be saved was taken away. All, not some, all was taken away. And we go on. Let's close with this. Time is about up. Look at the 137th Psalm. Your environment could affect your faith. The 137th Psalm. Yeah, I see. You'll be there. Some of you may not hear this teaching again for 10 years, because some of the things that you hear now are 10 years old. So you may not hear this again for 10 years. So it sounds strange in some of the years. I know. 10 years later on, you'll hear it again. Hallelujah. 137th Psalm. Your environment could affect your faith. My Jesus Christ. You get there in Calvary Hill, you start wondering, my God, my God. I know. Look at the 137th Psalm. Verse 1. By the river of Babylon, there we sat, there we wept when we remember Zion. Zion is the church. Remember Zion. Look at it. We hung our harp upon willows in the midst thereof. There they carry us away captive, require of us a song. That they wasted us and require us more, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Verse 4. Put your finger on verse 4. Look at verse 4. Yeah. All that street music in there, you can't hear you. You can't hear anything there. Yeah, you want us to sing a song of Zion in a strange land. Yeah, working. There's more darkness there, darkness is going to win. Jesus, when he went to his own home, he said he there could do no mighty work. Didn't say he didn't do it, could not do it. Look at verse 4. How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Can't sing it there. It's not going anywhere. Strange land. They want us to sing a song of Zion. How are we going to sing God?
Break every chain.
Come on,
set to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There's an army rising up. There's an army.